Welcome to worship from Daleville Christian Church. The news, latest news, is in our state that one of our hospitals received a request to take a patient from a state 600 miles away because that state's hospitals are full, mostly from COVID-19 patients. We continue to pray for our nation, pray for the world, pray for those who are medical staff and hospital staff trying to help those who are ill. Our affirmation of faith for today is from John's Gospel, again from John's Gospel, because it works well with today's Word of God. From John's Gospel in the first chapter. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. He was with God in the beginning. Through him all things were made. Without him nothing was made that has been made. In him was life, and that life was the light of humanity. The light shines in the darkness, and the darkness has not overcome it. The Word became flesh and dwelt among us. We have seen his glory, the glory of the one and only who came from the Father, full of grace and truth. The word of God for today is from the letter called 2 Peter in the third chapter, just the first two verses. Dear friends, this is now my second letter to you. I have written both of them as reminders to stimulate you to wholesome thinking. I want you to recall the words spoken in the past by the holy prophets and the command given by our Lord and Savior through your apostles. May the Lord add his blessing to this reading of his holy word. I've mentioned in a couple of sermons that Americans have trouble with the truth. Americans have trouble with what is true. A perfect example, with the recent flap about UFOs, whatever they may be, many people believe, and this belief started at Roswell, New Mexico, July 8, 1947, Americans began to believe that the U.S. government was withholding information about UFOs. Fast forward to 2020. The U.S. government is trying to tell Americans everything they know about the COVID-19 virus, and many Americans don't believe them. As my nephew said, the government can't win. And what it means is this: if the U.S. government would ever issue some sort of report on UFOs, many Americans will not believe it. For 9 years, the television program The X-Files was the longest running single series science fiction program ever on broadcast television. It touched on this topic I'm talking about. One of the taglines, one that many may remember, was this: the truth is out there. That's the part most of us remember. But the whole quote is, the truth is out there, but so are lies. Why does any of this matter to the followers of Jesus? Because we claim to have the truth. Our Lord Jesus said, I am the truth. Jesus said, "Then you will know the truth, and the truth will set you free." The word truth is in the Bible over 130 times, 23 times in John's Gospel alone. Very directly, here is the problem for those who claim to want to follow Jesus, who is the truth. Again, last June 2020, nearly two-thirds of Americans believe the COVID-19 pandemic is a message from God, but they disagree on the message. We took up this problem at Bible study last Wednesday. That these people disagree is not the biggest problem. The bigger problem is that although they claim to believe in God, they do not attend worship services. Friends, how is anyone going to get closer to the truth ignoring 2,000 years of experience in Jesus' church? Our Lord Jesus said to the Pharisees, "Nicodemus, but whoever lives by the truth comes into the light." I've also mentioned before my disappointment in the internet. The internet was intended as the information superhighway, an instrument for scientists to exchange results. Now you can use free Wi-Fi to put your two cents out there. You can talk about things you've never seen. You can talk about places you've never been. You are free to share your opinion on things you know nothing about. And you can get followers, thousands, millions, who will read or listen to you. There was a guy from our state, I will name him Kash Kelly. Kash Kelly was one of four from our state who stormed the Capitol building last January in Washington, D.C. Kelly was charged with knowingly entering or remaining in any restricted building or grounds without lawful authority and violent entry and disorderly conduct on Capitol grounds. But there is way more to this man's story. He will serve 4 years in prison on a drug charge. But his alleged participation in the Capitol insurrection in Washington, D.C. in January weighed heavily on the judges and the prosecutors' minds during his sentencing last February. Kashley Kelly, age 32, was sentenced to 4 years in prison, 3 years supervised release on conspiracy to possess with intent to distribute cocaine and marijuana during his time as a Latin King gang member. He was first indicted on the charge in 2015. Now, another part of this man's story is that he turned his life around after he left the gang. And as a part of his turnaround, Kelly has made a name for himself as a conservative podcaster. But Kelly made a mistake in going to Washington, D.C. and climbing the Capitol building with an American flag, and entering the building with the other offenders. And one more thing. Kelly is registered to vote in Lake County. According to his voting record, he has never voted in any election. Actually, I feel sorry for Kash Kelly. He wants to be an influencer for good now, but he went about it in the wrong way. And voting was never a part of trying to make a difference in the area of politics. Yes, you're free to have your opinion and share it and get followers. But shouldn't your opinion actually result in some life decisions, like actually voting for your candidate? That brings us to a whole other level of internet fame, and I want to share a little bit of this with you because I know as a group you are not very active on social media. First of all, there are a number of platforms or internet programs you can share your opinions on: Facebook is one. You've heard of it. YouTube. Daleville Christian Church uses both of those platforms. There's Twitter. There's Instagram. There's TikTok. One of my daughters tells me if you want, you could waste the rest of your life watching TikTok. On TikTok, you have 3 minutes to get your video message across. And there's Snapchat, but on Snapchat, you have only 60 seconds for your 2 cents worth. Now, some people on these platforms have followers, millions of followers. These people who have millions of followers have no degree. They are not experts at anything. They're not government leaders or CEOs. They are not inventors or even salespeople. However, some have the title influencer. One young woman is a billionaire now. Businesses want to get to know you if you are an influencer. One young woman says things about a product, whatever it is, and that can make or break a product and maybe make or break an entire company. You don't even have to be an adult. Tiana Wilson was 8 years old when she began making videos of opening new toys and talking about them. She's also the youngest female to have more than 10 million subscribers on her YouTube channel. That story is dated, though. Tiana Wilson, now age 15, has 11 million followers. And she's not the youngest person of those who have millions of followers. Do I have a problem with any of this? Well, not really, but all of this makes my job harder. I'm trying to get closer to the truth, and I'm trying to help you get closer to the truth. Social media is running interference with getting at the truth. It's a lot like the media preachers I talked about last time. They have platforms, they have their own media company to share their opinion. They may or may not be ordained. Most of them do not serve churches or answer to anyone but maybe their program's producer. Besides, in what way is Joel Osteen a pastor like I am a pastor? I'm certain I have no idea. Shouldn't Jim Baker's current ministry program carry a box that states Jim Baker was convicted of fraud, specifically 8 counts of mail fraud, 15 counts of wire fraud, and 1 count of conspiracy? Jim Baker was found guilty on all 24 counts, but since it's his own production company, I don't think Jim Baker's going to put that on the bottom of the screen of his streaming program. Today's Word of God. Dear friends, this is now my second letter to you. I've written both of them as reminders to stimulate you to wholesome thinking. I want you to recall the words spoken in the past by the holy prophets and the command given by our Lord and Savior through your Apostle. You see, friends, as we will learn in Bible study soon, decisions had to be made about which books to include in the New Testament. Remember what Luke wrote in his books, Luke and the Acts of the Apostles? Many have undertaken to draw up an account of the things that have been fulfilled among us, Luke wrote, just as they were handed down to us by those who from the first were eyewitnesses and servants of the word. With this in mind, since I myself have carefully investigated everything from the beginning, Luke wrote, I too decided to write an orderly account for you, so that you may know the certainty of the things you have been taught. So we learn from the first 4 verses of Luke's gospel, there are other written sources, and Luke might have some of them in front of him as he writes. They include things handed down that would be by word of mouth from people who were there and present when these things took place. And they became servants of that same word. So Luke says, I'm writing an account for you. Why? So that you may know the certainty of the things you've been taught. Luke himself, in his book of Acts, used his own diary or someone else's diary. And we know that's the case because he changes in the book of Acts from saying, they did this, to we went there and we did this. Remember, Luke suggests that he has other sources in front of him. This brings us to the question as to how the books in the New Testament got into the New Testament. There were four tests for any book that made it into the New Testament. The first test was apostolic authority. I won't take time to preach on the apostles. There were at least 12. Judas was replaced, as Luke reports it. There were at least two qualified to be apostles, Barsabbas and Matthias, and through prayer and casting lots, Matthias was enrolled. But Barsabbas was qualified to be an apostle. So what was written that got into what became the New Testament had to be apostolic. It didn't have to be in the apostles' handwriting, but it did have to come from them or from those people they taught and kept it in their teaching. We have covered the phrase the teaching before, and I invite you to look that up in your New Testament. Now, scholars like to argue about who wrote what. I've never been very concerned about it. The people who knew the people who were present said that these books reflect the teaching of the apostles no matter who wrote it. That's what is important. The second test was, if the writing was inspired, we have other writings from the time of Paul or right after Paul's time from church leaders in Egypt and Asia Minor and other places, but the letters are directed to one group about one thing or another. Kind of regular letters. The letters that are in the New Testament were recognized as of the Holy Spirit and therefore profitable for teaching, for reproof, for correction, and for training in righteousness. The third test for the books to get into the New Testament is the rule of faith. The book or letter has to be in agreement with all the other letters. And finally, and I think this is really important, the congregations had to agree that these books were worthwhile and were in use in their churches. They'd already proven their value in the churches. One man did not make the decision as to what gets into the New Testament. Not even a committee made the decision. The Holy Spirit in the churches recognized the Holy Spirit in the writings as being valuable for the whole church. Today's Word of God. Dear friends, this is now my second letter to you. I've written both of them as reminders to stimulate you to wholesome thinking. I want you to recall the words spoken in the past by the holy prophets and the command given by the Lord and Savior through your apostle. Friends, do you want to get closer to the truth? Here it is. It's not on Instagram. It does not tweet. You can't get the whole Bible on TikTok in 3 minutes. I think I'm most bothered that modern people believe that everyone in history before them was dumber than they are. Oh, maybe except the Egyptians and the Incas, but then they also believe that those civilizations got help from the aliens that the government supposedly won't talk about. Now, I've seen books published with the stupid title, Lost Books of the Bible. Those books are not lost. The church has known about those books from the time they were first written down. The problem with those books, they're not apostolic. They don't make the grade. Those books can't pass the tests. Those books might help us to understand some things that are in the New Testament, but I've never seen them quoted as helping us understand what the apostles were trying to say. Once in a while, the Bible gets into the news. Usually it's not in a good way. Way back in 2007, for whatever reason, the National Geographic Society decided to publish an English version of an ancient text so-called the Gospel of Judas. I'm guessing that someone in marketing came up with the title because I don't think the word gospel even shows up in that writing. The book opens with these words, the opening lines of the Judas book, the secret word of declaration by which Jesus spoke in conversation with Judas Iscariot. Or, as the secret word of the denial by which Jesus spoke in conversation with Judas Iscariot. I'm sure that you know, we know of nothing ever written by Jesus himself. And the disciples sure would have hung on to anything Jesus might have written, even if Jesus just wrote a check on a Nazareth bank. So was someone suggesting that Judas himself, in the wee hours of Thursday night to Friday morning, sat up all night and wrote this thing out in Greek when Judas probably spoke in Aramaic? And the only copies anyone has ever seen of this writing are in the Coptic Egyptian language. And that Judas wrote this down 20 years before any of the apostles wrote anything down? And yes, the church almost 2,000 years ago knew about this writing and basically said, why bother with this piece of drivel? This writing called a Gospel of Judas doesn't even begin to qualify to pass the tests of the books that were acceptable to have in the New Testament. It isn't a secret. This book or any other ancient book. The church looked at these books and read them, thought some of these books were pretty good, even helpful, but they weren't good enough. Dear friends, this is now my second letter to you. I've written both of them as reminders to stimulate you to wholesome thinking. I want you to recall the words spoken in the past, the command given by our Lord and Savior through your apostle. Friends, do you want to get closer to the truth?